bienvenidos a este nuestro coloquio internacional Explotación de Combustibles Fósiles No Convencionales en Estados Unidos y Canadá, Lecciones para América Latina, que coordinó y que preparó con mucho entusiasmo, con mucho tiempo de anticipación, nuestro querido colega y amigo, el doctor John Saxe Fernández. Y quiero decir que es de enorme importancia este coloquio, pues no solo para el CEICH, para la UNAM, y me atrevo a decir que para nuestro país, porque está poniendo, como lo hace siempre John Saxe, los puntos sobre las íes, el dedo en el renglón, de lo que es urgente. Temas importantes tenemos muchísimos en esta y otras universidades, pero hay temas que no solo son importantes, sino urgentes, porque nos llaman realmente a gritar con voz de alarma sobre lo que está pasando para reaccionar y no permitir que sigan los grandes despojos y que siga la destrucción de México y del mundo. Yo siempre he admirado al doctor John Saxe por una razón que voy a decir ahora. En esta universidad y en muchas otras, el pensamiento crítico se cultiva y se cultiva muy bien, y él es parte de este esfuerzo. Pero no todos cultivan el pensamiento crítico con tanta información y con un análisis muy refinado, sofisticado y certero de la información con la que él trabaja y con la que siempre nos sorprende, y a veces no solo nos sorprende, nos asusta muchísimo por las cosas que nos dice, pero que realmente nos tendrían que llevar, como decía yo, pues a no solo ejercer la crítica, poner la voz de alarma, sino plantear acciones que vayan en el sentido de por lo menos frenar, por lo menos incidir en la opinión pública para intentar poner freno a lo que está sucediendo. Hablábamos hace pocos años, se comenzó a hablar de un Estado fallido, nos quedamos cortísimos, comenzó una interesantísima discusión, fallido en qué, fallido para qué, fallido para quiénes. Es un Estado que en su alianza con poderes fácticos y con los grandes poderes del mundo, pues no tiene falla, ha cumplido con su papel. Después se comenzó a hablar de Estado asesino, de narcoestado. Hoy incluso hay quien lo califica como Estado gore, capitalismo gore, que corresponde a un Estado gore, que es realmente ya se instala en un ambiente en donde estamos ante una destrucción que no podíamos haber imaginado hace algunas décadas y ante la cual tenemos que reaccionar, porque ya no es solo la destrucción de la naturaleza, sino de la vida y de las vidas. En México, pues no tenemos que repetirlo, nos faltan 43 y nos faltan miles más, y lo tenemos que seguir repitiendo y poniendo siempre por enfrente en nuestros eventos esa falta, porque es algo que nos falta a todos y que seguiremos gritando por ello. Entonces, bueno, yo quiero agradecer desde luego a John Saxe por este evento, y pero no solo por este evento, sino por su certero trabajo en este centro, en esta UNAM y en este país. Y bueno, pues no quiero quitarles más tiempo, sino participar simplemente en la inauguración de este evento y darles de nuevo la bienvenida a todos, a los colegas extranjeros que nos acompañan. Welcome to Mexico and welcome our center. Y deseo que sean muy, muy exitosos sus debates. Me encantaría participar de ellos, pero no podré estar todo el tiempo presente. Muchas gracias.
Bueno, vamos a dar inicio a esta sesión. En la jornada de hoy hice un artículo donde se sintetiza la temática que se va a abordar y quiénes van a estar con nosotros. He pedido que les hagan llegar a ustedes el artículo
de hoy
sobre esta temática: geopolítica, energía, agua y territorio, en la que está la situación del fracking. Nada más que ahí relato mi sorpresa cuando en una reunión de los articulistas de la jornada con el secretario Caldwell y sus colaboradores, colaboradoras, nos dijo, en términos de la ecuación energética Estados Unidos-México, por la cual había que proceder con la reforma energética, porque Estados Unidos estaba a punto de transformarse en una nueva Arabia Saudita gracias a una técnica revolucionaria, una técnica limpia que generaba un combustible limpio que iba a ser un puente hacia otro patrón energético. Y me realmente me sorprendió, porque ya en ese momento habían aparecido estudios de John David Hughes, por ejemplo, Deborah Rogers, en materia de especulación financiera, David Hughes en materia de los límites geológicos del shale, pero fue el mismo paquete publicitario que usaba el Departamento de Estado, creo que la secretaria era Clinton, para la promoción en el mundo de una técnica que para nada era limpia. Había un estudio precisamente hecho en la Universidad Cornell, ahí estaba Anthony Ingrafia, sobre las fugas de metano. Y hoy en día, les decía ahora en la reunión con la directora, aparece un trabajo en los Proceedings of American Academy of Sciences, contándonos de una enorme fuga o fugas de metano detectadas por la NASA en 4 estados en el sur de Estados Unidos, y me sorprendió que saliera en esa publicación. Porque le atribuían a las actividades de la industria del gas y del petróleo esas fugas de metano, que tiene un efecto invernadero mucho mayor que el del CO2, aunque de menor tiempo de estancia en la atmósfera. También nos llegó noticia de que la Agencia del Medio Ambiente de Estados Unidos estaba a punto, la semana pasada, de permitir el verter de manera ilimitada las aguas que salen de la producción del fracking al Golfo de México. Y finalmente llegaron noticias de que California está importando gas y petróleo extraído por medio del fracking del Amazonas, que es una de las principales áreas forestales que van quedando en el planeta, en un mundo que se está calentando a unos niveles no detectados en cientos de miles o millones de años, por la cantidad de emisiones de gases de efecto invernadero en la atmósfera. Entonces, tenemos aquí algunos de los principales en esta materia. El doctor Anthony Ingrafia está ya en línea, nos va a ofrecer su reflexión en torno a esto, y tienen ustedes el programa, y sin más, procedemos de inmediato a aprovechar que el doctor Ingrafia está con nosotros también. Adelante.
Buenos días a todos. Ojalá pueda presentarles mi presentación hoy en español, pero lo siento mucho, no puedo. Entonces, tengo que hablar contigo hoy en inglés solamente, lo siento mucho. Muchísimas gracias. Vámonos. The talk I'm going to give today has this outline. These are the things that I want to do with you today. First, I want to try to explain what is new or what is proposed to be new about oil and gas development in Mexico. I will then proceed to explain that it's all about shale. That is what is new, shale. And so I have to describe to you what is the process for getting oil and gas out of shale, as is being done today in the United States, in Argentina, and just a few other places around the world. Then I will talk about what can go wrong and what does go wrong during this process. Finally, I will have some minutes to talk to you about what are the alternatives for your country. Instead of developing oil and gas from shale, what might Mexico be doing as an alternative energy policy? So these are the topics I'll talk about. Let's proceed. So what is new? You hear the word unconventional. Unconventional gas, unconventional oil. What does that mean? It means different. So this is the formal definition used by the oil and gas industry around the world to describe what is unconventional as opposed to what is conventional. And the key word here is the word permeability. So when we talk about shale, the essential fact about shale is its extremely low permeability. And that's what makes getting oil and gas out of it considered to be unconventional. Special techniques, relatively new techniques, totally different techniques are needed to get gas and oil out of shale compared to gas and oil out of traditional conventional sources. So first message is this talk and your issue is not fracking. Fracking is not new. Fracking is conventional. What is unconventional is shale. That's what's new. So why is it new to Mexico? Is there shale in Mexico? Gee. So here's a map that you've probably all seen of the regions of your country where there are known to be shale deposits. Maybe oil and gas, but certainly shale. And as you can see, it's concentrated down the eastern coast of your country with perhaps some in the interior. So that's where there might be gas and oil. That's certainly where there is shale. How much gas and oil is thought to be in those possible shale resources in your country? Well, my country, the United States, does a worldwide assessment every year. Where are the oil and gas resources? Where are the coal resources? Where are the fossil fuel resources in many of the countries around the world, including Mexico? And so last year, my country's Department of Energy issued a report, and they claim in that report that there are technically recoverable, and I will explain what technically recoverable means, technically recoverable shale resources in your country estimated at 545 trillion cubic feet, TCF means trillion cubic feet of natural gas, and 13 billion barrels of oil and condensate. Now those sound like very large numbers, so I have to put them in context for you. So first of all, what does technically recoverable mean? So here is an image that's used throughout the world to try to explain to you, the everyday person, and to regulators who might not know any better, and to legislators who usually do not know any better, and to journalists who almost exclusively don't know any better. Big numbers tend to get people very excited. But let's imagine that this large ellipse is the total amount of oil and gas possibly in Mexico in shale. That's what this big ellipse is, the total amount that's underground The technically recoverable part is always a small percentage of that. That's this darker blue area. That means you can't get everything that's down there out of the ground. It's technically impossible. So the technically recoverable resources are typically significantly lower than what's there. Smaller yet is the economically recoverable resources. So if you have 545 trillion cubic feet of natural gas that might be technically recoverable, you won't get it all because you will not be able to afford to get it all, certainly depending upon the price that someone's willing to pay for it. So the economically recoverable resources depends upon the marketplace. How much is someone willing to pay for the gas that could come out of the ground? And finally, you have proved resources. This is the percentage of the oil and gas in the shale that they know that they can get out of the ground at the price that people are willing to pay. And that's usually a very small percentage of the total and a very small percentage of the technically recoverable. So my message here is don't get confused and don't get excited or depressed about numbers like this. We have to realize that they are only possibilities. So let's see how possible these things are and what these numbers would mean to your country in terms of the energy that you consume or the energy you might want to sell to another country. So I did some research and I determined that on average in your country you use 1.9 million barrels of oil every day. That means Mexico consumes almost 700 million barrels of oil every year. So what does that mean? Well, let's assume that 50% of this 13 billion barrels of oil that might be there is actually recoverable. And I've been very conservative here. It's not likely that you're ever going to get 50% of it. The United States doesn't get 50% of its technically recoverable resources. What that means is if Mexico decided to develop all of its shale oil, it would only have about a 10-year supply for itself. And so then I ask the question, then what? An energy policy is going to be, it should be seeing farther out than a decade. When that oil is gone, what do you do next? And while you're using that oil, you're adding to climate change and you're adding to environmental degradation. On the natural gas side, your country consumes about 1.6 trillion cubic feet of natural gas per year. What does that mean? Well, again, if you assume that 50% of what might be in your shale deposits, assume 50% of it you could get out of the ground over the next 30 or 40 years, you would have 170-year supply of natural gas. Mexico would be independent of the need for importing natural gas for the foreseeable future and beyond, which means, given the marketplace, you're going to sell it to some other countries. You're going to liquefy it, and you're going to send it to Europe, and you're going to send it to Japan, and you're going to send it to other places around the world. It's not going to be a resource that's available for hundreds of years to Mexico. That's what's happened in the United States. The United States is going to be selling abroad much of its shale gas. So, second topic, now that you know where there might be gas and oil in shale, and now you know what might be the volume of natural gas and oil in shale, and now you know where it might go and how long it might last, what would it take to get it out of the ground? So I'm going to describe the overall process of developing oil and gas from shale as it has evolved in the United States over the last 20 years or so. This is the way it is done. It is the only way it can be done. And this is the way it would be done in Mexico. First, I have to describe the overall geographical picture. And I'm using images taken from the oil and gas literature here. So you can presume that this is from the horse's mouth. This is the industry telling the world how they do things. So here is the surface, some part of Mexico, maybe to be developed. And at each of these points I'm pointing to, there's a pad. A pad is the area where the oil and gas drilling takes place on the surface. So I'm showing you four pads here. And I'm showing you the distances, the average distances between the pads. I'm also showing you that from each pad, there are many wells that will be drilled. Conventionally, one pad. Unconventionally, many pads, many wells. So in this case, from each pad, you see six wells. And the drilling proceeds vertically downward and then laterally so that as much of the shale resource, that's this gray box, that's the shale where there's supposedly oil and gas. Since there's oil and gas everywhere in the shale, if the shale has any oil or gas, you have to drill everywhere to make it economically viable. That's the overall picture. That's very different from conventional. In conventional, I would have a pad with one well, and that well would go down into a pool, a volume of gas or oil that had accumulated in one place over hundreds of millions of years. That's not what happens in shale. What I'm showing you here is what has to happen. All right, what does this all mean? What does it really look like? Well, it means, as I said, you have to drill everywhere. You have to have closely spaced pads, and from each pad, many wells. And each of those wells is much larger in scale than conventional wells. So I call those two factors spatial intensity, many pads and many wells in a relatively small area compared to conventional, and technologies of scale. By that I mean to get oil and gas out of shale requires everything is bigger. Everything is bigger. And I'll describe that in more detail in the next few minutes. So first, spatially intense. This is a image of an area in Texas close to Dallas-Fort Worth where shale gas development first began commercially in the U.S. This is the Barnett, Texas shale gas play. Notice the scale. This is 4 kilometers. Every one of these white dots is a pad. I just showed you that a pad is an area where the drilling takes place. And on each one of those pads, there are multiple wells. So we'll zoom in, and now I'm showing you a 1 kilometer scale, and each one of those white dots is a pad. And every pad has multiple wells. That is spatial intensity. So what would that look like? Let's do a hypothetical. We'll imagine something that I hope never happens, which is somebody tries to get shale gas and oil out of a shale deposit in this region of Mexico. So I'm looking in this region, the Burgos Basin, and I'm going to look inside this red square. And I'm going to allow you to imagine what would happen like this in Texas. So here's that area of Mexico. Notice that there has already been some development. These are pads. But now let's put shale gas in that region or shale oil in that region. Every one of these yellow rectangles is an area that's going to be serviced by a pad that's this red dot. So here's a pad. Here's the area that that pad is going to service. Here's the next pad. Here's the next pad. Very similar to that image I showed you a few minutes ago. This is what it would look like. And from each pad, in this case, I'm showing 10 wells. 10 more. Akintuar. Eventually, the entire area would be developed, just like in the Barnett. So what? Well, so what? It's going to look like this. This is a modern, ultra-modern shale gas pad in British Columbia. And it looks a lot like an ultra-modern shale gas pad in Pennsylvania. The pads I showed you in Texas are 20 years old. They were relatively small. This is the modern way of doing things, where you have 10 wells on one pad. Here's your fresh water. And remember, we're talking about regions of Mexico that are traditionally not rich in water. Here's your freshwater man-made lake. This is the fresh water that goes down these wells. And this is the flow back that comes back. So a shale gas well is a conversion plant. It takes fresh water and makes it poisonous. You can drink this. You can't drink this. You can irrigate your farmland with this. You cannot irrigate your farmland with this. You can spill this and not worry about it. If you spill this, you have to worry about it. Technologies of scale. I said everything is bigger. Compared to the oil and gas development that you've seen onshore in Mexico in the last 40 or 50 years, shale requires larger drilling rigs and more power, larger fracking equipment with higher pressures, higher fluid volumes. The wells that the conventional wells that have been fracked in Mexico were fracked with perhaps a few hundred thousand liters of fracture fluid. Shale gas and oil wells use 20 million liters or more of fracturing fluid. And because you're using so much more fracturing fluid, you get so much more back as waste. That's called flowback. And that's waste. You have to find something to do with it. It has to be processed, transported, or disposed of. It's dangerous. It's hazardous. You're going to see larger and longer flaring and direct venting of methane into the atmosphere. Much more truck traffic, because you have to transport much more equipment, chemicals, water to the site, and then transport so much more waste away from the site. Every gas well has to be connected, or every oil well that's also producing gas has to be connected by a pipeline. So there will have to be thousands of miles of new pipeline constructed in Mexico, thousands of miles. You will need more and larger compressor stations and processing plants. I'll describe what those are in a minute. And of course, you'll be emitting more greenhouse gases. You'll be burning more oil and gas, and you'll be leaking more gas into the atmosphere. So I showed you a picture of a flowback impoundment in British Columbia. Here's a flowback impoundment in Pennsylvania. Notice the close proximity to private homes. This is flaring during the flowback period after fracking oil or gas. Well, in shale, there's a long period, days or weeks, of flaring off what they call waste gas. These flares can be dozens of meters high. They burn 24/7, 365, and they make very, very loud noises that can disturb people's sleep and disturb animal life. Compressor stations. The gas comes out of the ground. It's not at an appropriate pressure to go into a pipeline. The pressure has to be increased. They do that by building compressor stations, which themselves emit methane and consume enormous amount of power. So here's a modern compressor station in West Virginia. Each one of these houses, these compressor houses, has 4 or 5 2,000 horsepower pumps. And frequently, when a compressor station has an event, an excess pressure event, or a problem, they have what's called a blowdown. So I'm going to show a video here, which I hope you can see and hear. So this is direct venting. This is not a flame. This is direct venting of methane, natural gas, into the atmosphere at extremely high pressure. That is a very potent greenhouse gas, and also a gas that's harmful to human health for what it does to local air quality. That's direct venting. Processing. The first place that shale will be developed is where there is expected to be one case. So this is a steel pipe called casing. It's called the production casing. It's that steel pipe that is supposed to be transporting, in this case, natural gas from a shale formation many thousands of meters below the surface to the surface, so it goes into a pipeline to the market. So I emphasize that what you're supposed to see here, or not see, I should say, and not hear, is natural gas coming up the inside of this pipe. What you're not supposed to see is this. So what you see here is this bubbling in the water is natural gas that's leaking outside of this well. This is rainwater that has accumulated around the wellhead. You'll see an image in a few minutes of what I call the wellhead. That's where the well emerges from the ground and goes into a pipeline. But in this case, a lot of the methane is not going into the pipeline. It's going into the atmosphere. That's bad. What's even worse is that that methane has to go through the water table. To get to the surface, it had to go through the water table, which is supplying drinking water to people in this region. And just like in Pennsylvania and West Virginia, I suspect that a large percentage of the people in Mexico who are living over shale formations have private water wells. They're drawing water from an aquifer. This is an image, again, prepared by the oil and gas industry that shows what can and does go wrong with the whole process. So here's a video where the red dots are gas bubbles. And in the best of all circumstances, those gas bubbles go to the surface inside the steel pipe called the production casing. Here's your water aquifer where you're drilling your private water wells. Everything is fine. Here are the things that can go wrong and do go wrong. Cement channeling. Cement is a gasket. It's material that's inserted into the gas well to form a seal so that the well doesn't leak. But you're inserting this steel thousands of meters, and it doesn't always work perfectly. And if it doesn't work perfectly, then some of those gas bubbles can get into the soil and the rock and into your freshwater aquifer. The casing itself is steel casing. It can crack, it can corrode, and if it does, it can leak. Or they might not have enough cement. They didn't put cement everywhere in the well they were supposed to put it. In which case, again, you can have a well that leaks. The reason I'm showing you these images is because you need to know that the industry knows that there are these problems. And yet you will hear from the industry, if you haven't already, and you will hear from your legislators and your regulators that our wells don't leak. There's never been a single documented case of fracking causing contamination of a freshwater aquifer. But I didn't talk about fracking here. This has nothing to do with fracking. This has everything to do with drilling the well, putting casing in the well, and putting cement in the well. If you're not doing those things correctly, your well will leak, regardless of whether it's fracked or not. So don't be confused by what you hear from others. Recently, we published a study where we went to a state in the United States, Pennsylvania, where there have now been almost 10,000 shale gas wells drilled, a state which says that they have the toughest regulations in the world. And what we found is that unconventional wells, shale gas wells, over 6% of them were already leaking within the first 3 years of their lives. One out of every 16 modern shale gas wells in a state with very tough regulations was leaking in the first 3 years of its life. When we went to a region where there had not been previous drilling, an area that where the geology was different than what it was in Texas and not completely understood, an area where many companies went very quickly, including companies with not very much experience, one out of every 10 wells was already leaking. What I just described was Mexico. It's a place where there has not been any shale gas development yet. It's a place where many companies would like to go that don't have very much experience, or one company with no experience is going to go. And it's a place where the geology is relatively not understood. So I'd be willing to bet that if this ever happens, that you're going to see a number like 10%, not a number like 6% or a number like 2% of those shale gas and oil wells leaking very early. I promised I'd say a few words about earthquakes. It's called human-induced seismicity. Can human activities cause earthquakes? The answer is yes. That's indisputable. Can the development of shale gas and oil cause earthquakes? Well, if you live in Texas, the answer is no. If you live in Oklahoma or Arkansas or Ohio or Colorado or British Columbia or England, the answer is yes. So there's obviously some political influence on the answer. So there are two ways that the development of large volumes of oil and gas from shale can cause earthquakes. One is called indirect, and that's not because of the fracking of the well, but because of the waste that's produced from the well. Remember those ponds I showed you with those enormous quantities of flowback? In many places in the U.S., that flowback is put back into the earth in special wells, wells that do not produce oil and gas, but they accept waste products from oil and gas. And that's what's been happening in many states in the U.S. So here is a graph that shows the number of earthquakes recorded in Oklahoma since the year 2000. And you'll notice that the number has increased substantially. And it's increased substantially since about 2009. What do you suppose has been happening in and around Oklahoma since 2009? There's also the possibility of a direct cause of an earthquake from fracking itself. Fracking, by definition, is the creation or the extension of discontinuities in rock. That's the definition of an earthquake. So this is an article from the newspaper called, the journal called Energy. It says in December of last year, there was a 4.6 magnitude earthquake in British Columbia caused by fracking. And in December of last year, it was thought to be the largest earthquake ever caused by fracking. 1 month later, it was exceeded. And you might have heard that there was a magnitude 5.6 earthquake in Oklahoma caused indirectly by fracking. So there's great concern around the world right now among seismologists about how large an earthquake can be caused, either indirectly or directly, from oil and gas development. We don't know the answer, but what we do know is over the last few years, the maximum magnitude of these human-induced earthquakes has been increasing. So there is concern that we could see much larger earthquakes. Next topic, methane emissions. If you're going to be producing a lot more methane from shale gas and oil wells, you have to face the fact that methane is a very potent greenhouse gas. It's not only carbon dioxide that's important, it's methane that's important. And methane is just as important as carbon dioxide over the next 20 years. And so I was lucky enough to be a co-author of a paper that we published 5 years ago, in which we said that getting gas out of a shale gas well is worse than getting gas out of a conventional well, and it's worse for the climate than burning coal and mining coal, and it's worse for the climate than producing oil. And we predicted back then that somewhere between roughly 4% and roughly 8% of all of the methane, all the natural gas that's coming out of gas and oil wells in the U.S. was never being burned. It was getting into the atmosphere as leakage, either purposeful or accidental, but it was getting into the atmosphere. And since that time, 2011, there have been many studies done in the U.S. that show that very substantial amounts, in some cases, some regions even higher than this number, of methane is in fact leaking into the atmosphere. Our government now recognizes that. Initially they said, no, that's not possible. But the U.S. government has now said, yeah, it is possible. Methane is important. Our White House published a climate action plan strategy to reduce methane emissions from oil and gas. They recognize that. Here is the graph that shows carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere. Certainly the concentration of carbon dioxide is increasing. You probably read that this year will be the first year that we will be way over 400 parts per million at a time when we should be at the lowest value of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Month of September in the Northern Hemisphere, we're actually above 400 parts per million. But let's look at methane. Look what's happened to methane concentration in the atmosphere. Since roughly 2007, 2008, its concentration is increasing. And again, I ask rhetorically, what do you suppose was happening in the U.S. starting in around 2007, 2008? Shale gas, shale oil. So now our Environmental Protection Agency is issuing new regulations to try to drastically reduce methane emissions. I show this picture to give some of your legislators and perhaps your president some ideas. Here is our president meeting with the Premier of Canada this year, where they announced a joint plan to curb methane emissions from Canada and from the United States. And they would do that by targeting oil and gas production. I would hope that sometime in the near future, your president would be standing here, joining Canada and the United States in trying to do everything we can to reduce methane emissions in our three countries, not just two of them. And I promised I would mention health impacts and only mention that you're going to hear much more in detail from Dr. Seth Shomkoff. He's in the room with you right now. He'll be part of many of your panels over the next today and tomorrow, and he'll be giving a lecture tomorrow on what we have found, our organization, he's the executive director, on the negative health effects from the development of shale gas. These are the negative health effects that you could expect to see in your country. So please attend his lecture. Finally, I want to talk about alternatives. You're at a crossroads. Mexico's at a crossroads. You're not doing any significant development of shale gas and oil. You might have significant shale gas and oil resources. Should you go ahead and develop them? Knowing that if you do, you're going to have all the impacts I described and all the health impacts that Dr. Shomkoff will describe. And you'll be doing it at a time that is the worst possible time from the point of view of climate change. Many countries, many regions, many provinces, many states have already declared through the Paris Accords that they will keep much of their fossil fuels in the ground. They will not develop them. My state, New York, not the city, the entire state of New York, has decided that we will not develop our shale resources. We said no. That's our voluntary contribution to not enhancing, making climate change worse. So what is Mexico doing? What could Mexico do? Well, we have to talk about climate change for a few minutes. This is information and some graphs taken out of the most recent paper by Dr. James Hansen. You might remember him. He's the fellow who first went to the United States Congress in the late 1980s. 30 years ago, went to the Congress of the United States and said, climate change is happening. And since then, he's been a vociferous spokesperson and a fantastic scientist, publishing many papers talking about the science of climate change. This is his most recent paper, came out last week. And what he's showing is a graph of global warming, degrees centigrade, as a function of time. And what he's attempting to show here in both of these graphs is that the rate of increase of global warming is increasing. If you were to take this red dotted line and say, well, this is the rate of increase of global warming, you'd have to take into account that, look, in the past 2 years or 3 years since 2010, actually the last 2011 to 2016, last 5 years, we've seen a tremendous acceleration of climate change. It's happening faster than we predicted. And one of the reasons he cites for this acceleration is the drastic increase of methane emissions in the atmosphere. That's James Hansen saying that. Read the paper. So with that as background, what's Mexico going to do to help in the fight against climate change? You signed the Paris Accords. Got a long way to go. This is a graph of your present. This is your Mexico's present energy picture. 93% of all the energy consumed in your country is from fossil fuels. Mostly natural gas, obviously, and petroleum, some coal. 93%. So let's talk about renewable energy as an alternative. What else? We'll talk about wind for a few minutes, then we'll talk about the sun. And I should point out that Mexico has substantial wind resources and substantial sun resources. So here is the most recent report from the United States Department of Energy, which shows worldwide how countries are doing in producing electricity from the wind. So this graph is the percentage of all the electricity produced in a country that's coming from wind. It's a renewable, green, renewable energy source. Here's Denmark. 40% of all the electricity in Denmark comes from the wind. Here's Germany. 15% of all the electricity consumed in Germany comes from the wind. Here's the United States. 5% of all the electricity consumed in the United States, produced in the United States, comes from the wind. Here's Mexico. 3% of all your electricity as of 2015 was coming from the wind. Like you, I don't like this. I don't want to see the United States in 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12. I don't want to see the United States in 15th place. I don't want to see Mexico in 20th place. We're supposed to be leaders. The sun, photovoltaic generation of electricity. On the left is a list of the top 10 countries in the world based on total photovoltaic solar energy capacity, how much they can generate from the sun. The leader is China, followed closely by Germany, then Japan, way down in fourth place, the United States. I don't see Mexico in the top 10. In fact, Mexico in 2015 was number 32 in the world. Now, I want to point out that Mexico is much larger than Germany, much larger than Japan, much larger than Italy, much larger than the United Kingdom, much larger than France, much larger than Spain. In fact, if you added the land area of Germany, Japan, Italy, and France, you'd get about the same land area as your country. So it can't be land area. Maybe it's the fact that the sun doesn't shine in Mexico. I'm going to show you two pictures to contrast. On the left is a map of Germany. On the right is a map of your country. The colors indicate solar intensity. How many kilowatt hours of sunshine do you get on 1 square meter of Mexico? How many kilowatt hours of sunshine do you get on 1 square meter of Germany? Now, I got to warn you, you probably can't read the fine print here, but there's two different color scales here. In Germany on the left, the deepest color is, let me put my glasses on so I can read it, 1200 kilowatt hours per square meter. That's the blue color in Mexico. I want to repeat that. I want to make sure you understand. The darkest color in Germany is the lightest color in Mexico. So there is no place in Mexico that does not get more sun than Germany. There is no place in Mexico that does not get more sun than the place in Germany that gets the most sun. So there's no excuse. You have an extremely wonderful situation to rapidly advance the generation of electricity for all purposes in Mexico. You can use that electricity for air conditioning. You can use that electricity for home heating. You can use that electricity to power electric cars. You can use that electricity to power your industry. You do not need fossil fuels for all those sources, all those sinks, I should say. You do not need fossil fuels. It's just more convenient right now to use fossil fuels. But we have this constraint called climate change, and we have this constraint called human health. And those two constraints should be telling you what to be doing. I hope I'm suggesting. We're not much better off than you are. I'm not bragging about the United States' fantastic achievements in replacing fossil fuels with renewable energy. We're not a leader either. Both our countries should be leaders. So let me summarize. Most of what I said, as simply as I can say it again. You have the opportunity to make a decision as a country to proceed with development of your shale resources for oil and gas. But if you do, you will suffer the consequences of spatial intensity and technologies of scale. In particular, the risk of groundwater contamination in your country will be very high, not because of fracking, but because of leaking wells, surface spills, and waste disposal. Those are the lessons that are being learned in the U.S. Your landscape will be changed over very large areas, and that landscape will be considerable and permanent. Your regulations and your regulators are not ready. Your regulations were written long before there was ever a notion of the shale gas and shale oil revolution. The potential net economic outcome. Well, let's look what happened in the U.S. Shale gas and oil boomed, and then they busted. Shale gas oil and shale gas production in the United States is on decline. I want to make sure you understand that. It's in decline. It lasted for 15 years and gone. Now what? There's nothing left. There'll be more oil and gas coming out of shale in the U.S., but it's not going to last forever. It's not going to last 100 years. It's not going to last 50 years. And if it lasts 20 years, and we use it during those 20 years, we will have done very, very, very bad damage to our efforts to combat climate change. You can't have it both ways. So finally, you know, I know everybody in that room, nobody in that room is going to say climate change is a myth created by the Chinese. So if Mexico goes the way that the U.S. has, you'll be adding additional carbon dioxide and methane to the atmosphere at a time when we should be decreasing both greenhouse gases because climate change is accelerating. Don't throw more gas on the fire, please. I beg you. My final word, do everything you can, legally. Do everything you can scientifically. Do everything you can technologically. Do everything you can sociologically, economically, regulatorily, to get Mexico to say no. So thank you all for your attention. I hope we have some time for questions and I'll be able to understand them. Thank you very much.
Preguntas. Sí.
Mi nombre es Claudia Campero, participo en la Alianza Mexicana contra el Fracking y trabajo para Food and Water Watch. Mi pregunta es, sabemos que también se realiza fracking en pozos convencionales o en otras formaciones rocosas que no son shale. Y quisiera conocer si hay impactos diferenciados, es decir, si el hecho de que el fracking se realice en shale hace una diferencia a que se realice en otras formas rocosas en cuanto a sus impactos ya descritos.
Muchas gracias. Así, preguntas muy concretas, por favor.
I think I understood. Part of the question was, is fracking that's done in shale going to have different impacts than fracking that's done in conventional wells? Is that correct? That's the correct question?
Yes.
Okay, the answer is yes. So let me tell you why. The wells, the oil and gas wells that have been drilled onshore in Mexico, most of them have been fracked. That might come as a surprise to you, but it's very rare nowadays, certainly in the last 20 years, last 30 years. It's very rare when any oil or gas well, conventional oil or gas well, is not fracked. Fracking is a process by which you stimulate an oil or gas well to be more productive. So when I first started working in fracking back in the 1980s, we had what was called massive hydraulic fracturing. Massive. We used that word, massive hydraulic fracturing. And we would use a few hundred thousand liters of fracking fluid. We thought that was big. A few hundred thousand liters. Half a million liters. Now, the wells that are being drilled in Pennsylvania and in British Columbia and in West Virginia and in Ohio consume 20 million liters, in some cases twice that, 30 million liters, 40 million liters. So the first answer to your question is yes, we have to use more water. And because we're using more water, we're using more chemicals. And because we're using more water and more chemicals, we run risks that are much higher. If you're using 100 times more water and chemicals than you were using in a conventional well, the risk of to the water supply is greater, the risk of spilling those chemicals is greater. So just getting to the point where you're going to frack brings with it higher risks. And now you frack. Is there a possibility that injecting 20 million liters or more of fracking fluid into a shale formation that's 1,500 meters underground is going to lead to direct contamination of an aquifer? Of course it's higher risk. Yes. Anytime in the engineering world, I'm an engineer, I've been one for over 50 years. Anytime in the engineering world where something becomes bigger, the risks become higher. So now you do the fracking, and the fracking itself has a higher risk of contaminating water supplies. And then we go to the next stage, after fracking. Now you have to recover. I showed you those ugly pictures of ugly pools of flowback. You're going to get millions of liters coming back of each well. Each well will be sending up back to the surface millions of liters of contaminated, poisonous, hazardous water. What are you going to do with it? You're going to go dump it in the ocean? You're going to put it in ponds and let it evaporate? You're going to push it down a hole? Well, that's a lot of those things are happening. But it's an enormous technological challenge to handle all the waste, and it's expensive. Companies don't really want to spend a lot of money handling the waste. They make their money selling the product. They're losing money handling the waste. So now your risks are much higher than conventional wells from fracking because you have more waste from fracking. And finally, it's much less likely that fracking a conventional well is going to cause an earthquake, either indirectly or directly. It's much more highly probable that fracking a shale gas or shale oil well, much more highly probable that you'll have seismicity that you don't want in a country where seismicity is a very important concern. Thank you. Great question.
Bueno, mi nombre es Carlos Álvarez y mi pregunta es muy concreta. Si usted ha tenido alguna reacción por parte del lobby petrolero, por parte del gobierno de los Estados Unidos, acerca de su posición y de sus, digamos, estudios científicos en esta posición que usted tiene acerca del fracking. Gracias.
I think someone needs to repeat that question because I couldn't hear it.
Okay, la pregunta es si usted ha tenido alguna reacción por parte del lobby petrolero o por parte del gobierno de los Estados Unidos acerca de su posición sobre el fracking, ¿no? Y sus estudios científicos que muestran todas estas complicaciones, ¿no?
Okay, the problem I'm having is I'm hearing the Spanish and the English at the same time, and so I can't separate. So if you could just repeat the question in English.
Ella la puede hacer.
He's asking whether you have had a reaction by the industry with all the studies and all what you have said about the risks.
Yes.
The industry and the government.
We have had reactions we started doing all these studies in 2009, 2010. And we have had many reactions from the industry and many reactions from the government and many reactions from our regulators. And in obviously almost all cases from the industry, the reaction has been negative. They've said we're wrong, that our science is bad, that we don't know what we're talking about, that we're cooking the science. Well, we don't believe what they're saying, they don't believe what we're saying, but we're not the only people saying it. So Dr. Shonkoff tomorrow is going to talk. When we began our studies, of shale gas and oil, all the impacts, impacts on water, impacts on air, impacts on human health, impacts on earthquakes, literally five or six papers have ever been published in 2009, 2010. We started publishing. Other scientists and engineers around the world also began investigating. As of today, there are 950 papers peer-reviewed in the formal scientific literature. And you'll hear from Dr. Shonkoff tomorrow. I won't let the cat out of the bag, but you'll hear what percentage of those papers are saying the things that we began saying in 2009, 2010. The things I said today. We were saying 6 or 7 years ago.
Hay una interrupción ahí. Está diciendo que el doctor Shonkoff va a referirse a algunos de estos problemas.
And we said that shale gas is worse than coal, and shale gas is worse than oil, and shale gas is worse than conventional gas from the point of view of climate change. The United States White House, the Secretary of Energy of the United States, publicly criticized us and said we were wrong. He's now saying we were right. You know, time goes by, additional scientists get involved. They do the studies that are recommended by other scientists. They build on previous scientific work, and you start to establish a consensus. So there is now a consensus that far more methane is getting into the atmosphere than our government thought in 2011, far more. There's also a scientific consensus. I talked about it from Jim Hansen's paper from last week. There's now a scientific consensus that there's far more methane in the Earth's atmosphere than there was 10 years ago. And there's scientific consensus, as evidenced by the accord signed in Paris last year, that the effect of methane in the atmosphere has been underestimated. Methane is a much more potent greenhouse gas than we thought 5 years ago. So the U.S. is emitting more methane. There's more methane in the whole Earth's atmosphere. And what it does to climate change is worse than we thought. Now, are we being criticized anymore on those three factors? By the industry, yes. By the government, no. The industry will always criticize what we say. We're trying to drive them essentially out of business. Not tomorrow. But hopefully in the next two decades, we see the eventual managed decline of the fossil fuel industry. That's how it has to be. I don't want all those people to lose their jobs tomorrow. I don't want everybody to freeze in the dark tomorrow. I'm not saying shut down all oil and gas and coal usage tomorrow. That's impossible to do. What is possible and what must be done is a managed decline at the highest rate that each country can find feasible. And you're a country where you have a very interesting choice. You haven't done any yet. Mexico can claim that it's not responsible. It is not responsible for worsening climate change because it decided to develop shale gas and oil. You can claim innocence. And you can stay innocent. Or you can join the countries like the United States and Argentina who have said, yeah, we're gonna do that. In fact, we're going to increase the development of gas and oil, not decrease it. So, long answer to your question, the industry will never be happy with anything the science says, real science. Some governments have already agreed. Yep. Yeah, there's science here that says this is not a good thing. We shouldn't be doing it at all. And there are some governments like mine who are saying, yeah, well, we understand the science. We understand how bad this really is. But, you know, politics are politics. And we got to keep people happy. And we can't get enough renewables soon enough to stop developing fossil fuels. And that's I'm sorry, I can't accept that. You manage both at the same time. That's what governments functioning well do. They work with industry, and they work with the people in their countries to do the right things. That's what Germany has done. Germany has told its fossil fuel industry, shut down. Not tomorrow, you got 20 years. And it's told its renewable industry, spool up. Not tomorrow, you got 20 years. And they started that 10 years ago. Mexico can do the same thing.
¿Alguna otra observación?
Any other, hay más preguntas?
Quiero recordar a ustedes que vamos a tratar el TISA, el acuerdo de servicios internacional y el acuerdo transpacífico en el cual se establecen normas trinquete, es decir, que el país que abre su sector a este tipo de tecnologías, una vez hecha la decisión, no puede volver atrás. Se llama la cláusula trinquete. Está en uno de los anexos del Tratado de Servicios y del Acuerdo Transpacífico, de tal manera que este mismo gobierno está cerrando las puertas para revertir este proceso, porque le da a las compañías fósiles todas las ventajas para recurrir a tribunales internacionales y desactivar los tribunales nacionales. Entonces, en ese sentido, es ardua la lucha que tenemos en México para evitar precisamente esto que es inminente en términos. Y por otra parte, el Acuerdo de París no es vinculante, en tanto que el Acuerdo Transpacífico y el Acuerdo de Servicios sí es vinculante y tiene categoría constitucional. Esa es la gran diferencia. Es una observación, no es una pregunta. Pero la vamos a tratar. Espero que con Andrés Barreda y otros de los compañeros. No hay más preguntas. Yo quiero agradecerle al doctor Anthony Ingrafia su participación realmente sólida, extraordinariamente valiosa para nosotros. Y le mandamos un gran abrazo desde México. Gracias. Vamos a seguir de inmediato con Tony Clark.
Good morning, everybody. Buenos días. I think that incredible presentation we've just had sets the stage very nicely, and much to my surprise, kind of parallels a little bit what I was going to say. Okay, I just want to, let me pick it up and start all over again by saying that this is really a great momentous occasion in many ways, bringing together activists as well as academics together to, in a university setting, to actually explore what may be the fundamental challenges that we face in the 21st century. So I want to pay tribute to John Sachs Fernandez for the leadership that he has given in moving this in this direction, and also to say how happy I am to participate from Canada and to be with you, learning from the rest of you what's happening in the rest of the hemisphere and what we're up against. So I just wanted to thank you very much for that. Secondly, I just want to say I apologize for my presentation will be verbally in English. The slides I've had translated, so we'll have a basic presentation in Spanish on the slides, but obviously I will be speaking in English, and so apologies for that, but that's just the way it is. And thirdly, I just want to say that what a wonderful moment this is in terms of bringing, as I said, together activists and academics together in a process of dialogue. And I'm reminded constantly of the great Brazilian educator, Paulo Freire, who told us that if you really want to transform the world, you don't have to learn how to act alone, you also have to learn how to reflect on your actions. And that's the way we transform the world. And I think that this is the interaction between academics and activists in this context is really important. I am among the activists, even though I've had training, formal training in the university context and everything else. I'm among the activists, and so therefore I stand with all activists in this context. To begin with, I'm going to discuss various aspects of the Canadian experience and tell the story. First of all, to look at two examples of extractivism. The fact that Canada has an extractivist economy has had from the very beginning, and but the two forms of extractivism which are unconventional are the tar sands development in Alberta and liquefied natural gas and the corresponding use of hydraulic fracturing in that process. And look at those two examples and then go on from there to relate these, both of these examples, to the meltdown that's going on in the Arctic and what that really means. Because keep in mind that the proximity of Canada to the Arctic is much greater than Mexico's proximity to the Arctic. And we are accelerating the process there of the meltdown that's taking place in the Arctic through what we are doing in these kinds of unconventional processes of extraction. And then from there to go further to discuss what kinds of challenges emerge for the future in addressing these kinds of issues. And how we have developed a plan of action that we're trying to develop in Canada in the social movements to advance an agenda for transformation. And I'll try to lay that out if time permits, okay? So I just want to proceed then, first of all, by talking a little bit about the extractivism history in Canada and what we're dealing with here. And recognizing that we're talking about a centuries-old process. Canada has always been a country that has been blessed, if you will, with natural resources that range from... I'm getting a signal from the back there. No? Okay. Natural resources such as fish and fur and timber. Then also hydropower and minerals, and a variety of minerals that have been sought by industrial powers, and then thirdly, more recently, oil and gas. And this kind of process has been going on And in the history of the country, from which began really in around 1604, before the, after the occupation of the land by various Europeans. And then we had the evolution of an extractivist economy that was trading, exporting our furs and our fish and our timber to Europe, and then from then on, moving further with that kind of process. So we have been tied to industrial powers from the very beginning, and this extractivist model is not new to Canada. It has been a part of who we are. And we're at a point now because of the kind of challenges we're facing today that extractivist model has to fundamentally be transformed and changed. And there is no other alternative for us. We have lived under three empires in this process: the French Empire in the 16th through the parts of the 17th century, followed by the British Empire from the 17th and 18th and 19th centuries, and then the American Empire in the 20th century. And this means that our economy, for all intents and purposes, has been forged in the cradle of these three empires over that span and period of time. So that's the kind part of the background that I wanted to share with you on that point. So we have emerged as one of the most vital extractivist economies to be found anywhere in the world today. Not only Canada's natural resources, but we've built up an industry of dealing with this and an export and import trading policy that has facilitated this from the word go. And so this kind of process exists, and part of the Canadian extractivist story is the emergence of a huge mining conglomerate, and where we have among the largest and certainly number-wise, we have most of the mining companies in Canada are operating internationally, and so that this becomes a real major problem. And I'm expecting to hear from some of our countries here in Latin America about complaints that people will have with Canadian companies and what they have done. So really, basically, if you want to know more about this, there is a document and a paper that has been written by Ricardo Grinspan and also Jennifer Mills, called Canada, Extractivism, and Hemispheric Relations. And I commend that paper simply because it summarizes very nicely from these two professors at York University in Toronto the history of our extractivism and how it's evolved and developed. Having said that, though, I want to point out that we're up against a different reality today. And when we hear about the question of what is the geopolitical challenge in front of us, in many ways, I would like to argue today anyway that not only is water, which I fundamentally agree with, is a geopolitical challenge we face today, but so is climate change, just as the previous presentation emphasized. And I want to point out that the relationship between climate change and the global economy is extremely interrelated, and one is not going to be resolved without dealing with the other. In other words, we're not going to be able to resolve the whole challenge of climate change without coming to grips with the fundamental contradictions that exist in terms of the global economy. The fact that TISA was mentioned a few moments ago and the TPP, these two trade processes, international trade negotiations that are taking place, are a prime their purpose is to facilitate and accelerate the processes of the global economy on the one hand, at the very same time as we're dealing with the fundamental challenges of climate change. And what do we find in TISA but an open door saying, come on in and continue to frack and frack and frack. Free will be the name of the game. So I just want to kind of point out that those connections really do exist. The evidence is mounting in terms of climate change. I think we're all aware of the fact that 2015 was the hottest year on record since 1850, and when records started being kept. We have a situation in October of 2016, only 16 years after the beginning of the 21st century. What's happened is that the planet's temperature is very close now to have risen in this century already in those 16 years by 1.5 degrees. This 1.5 degrees was the target that was set in Paris, reducing it from 2 degrees to 1.5 degrees as a target we would shoot for reductions in greenhouse gas emissions in order to be able to keep the temperature, the overall global temperature this century to 1.5 degrees, and we are already very close to surpassing that within the first 16 years. So according to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Association itself, this whole process of global climate change is now being driven very much by a concentration of greenhouse gas emissions, and I will talk and add to what was said earlier about methane in a few moments. But it's also the El Niño effect too that's been a part of the process. And we add El Niño to this, it doesn't cover a great deal of the reason for this. The real reason is the concentration of greenhouse gas emissions, and the acceleration is methane. And those are the processes I think we need to keep in mind as we go through this. So whichever way you look at it, we have a problem with what I call runaway climate change. It's getting out of hand. We're getting out of control. We really don't have the human control over it. We have a Paris Accord that says we ought to hit these targets, but no roadmap to get there. And that's the fundamental problem, among the fundamental problems that we're up against. So here, when you talk about when we talk about the economy in Canada and we talk about the environment in Canada, the lightning rod is pipelines. Pipelines become the topic of conversation that opens up the discussion about the economy and the ecology, or opens up the relationship to climate change. The reason for that is that Canada is in that position where all of its production of either oil or shale gas or anything else is landlocked. It's got to get from where it is, where the extraction takes place, and it's got to get to markets. And so the big point is constantly looking at and proposing and dealing with the various possibilities of pipelines that could be built. And so here we have a situation where we have a multiplicity of pipeline projects. And the ones in different colors here, Northern Gateway, Energy East, the Trans Mountain Pipeline, you remember the Keystone XL and the Alberta Clipper expansion and Line 9 reversal. Those are some of the major pipeline proposals to dealing with getting the tar sands production to markets alone. And that's the kind of debates we end up having in Canada. We end up having debates over pipelines and which proposals would work best and not work best, or which should be stopped, or if they all should be stopped. And in the midst of all of that, the issue of the economy comes up, and the issue of climate change and the ecology comes up. So that's the kind of context in which we're dealing with this. Final point in this first and opening discussion about the context in which we're operating is to look at a a prime minister that came into power 1 year ago and smiling, saying sunny days are back again, sunny days are here again, only to find that after a year in office, there are some real problems and complications that he has to address. And all the great talk about favoring all of these things, yes, we're going to be at the forefront of the Paris Climate Accord. Yes, we're going to restore the dignity of, or help restore the dignity of indigenous peoples in our country. Yes, we're pro-environment. Yes, 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 down the line, only to find out that there are other people yelling in his ears who are saying giving opposite messages and realizing that there are some real conflicts ahead. The situation, just as Anthony spoke in that last presentation about the contradictions that exist, you can't have both, you gotta make your choices. The same thing arises for Trudeau. You cannot build the economy on the basis of the model we had historically of an extractivist economy. You cannot do that and still end up being a champion in the fight against climate change and the degradation of the environment. You cannot do that. The challenge is to transform the economy in harmony with nature and the ecology. And to do that requires a fundamental overhaul of the basic mechanisms of our political economy in our country. Okay. We're going to turn now to the Alberta tar sands as a quick example of what we're talking about here. It is the largest mega development on the planet, and by that I mean basically we are dealing with a potential development if the technology were there to do it. Just as was being said in the previous presentation, you can talk about the size of the source of the oil and the gas that's in the ground, but you have to ask the question, what can be technically recoverable? Right now, only a little over 20% of what is in the tar sands can be technically recoverable. Yet the whole of the tar sands far outstrips, I mean, its potential far outstrips what exists in terms of even Saudi Arabia or even Venezuela. But the problem, of course, is that the technology is not there yet, thank God, is not there yet to take it all out of the ground. What we're dealing with here is a, geographically speaking, and this is an extrapolation out of the tar sands. Tar sands is really down here. And so the challenge that's there is to recognize that this is a huge area of land. It's the size of England right now, which is a very large chunk of land that is under development with regards to the tar sands itself. The tar sands is really essentially extracting bitumen from below the sedimentary rock basin. The sedimentary rock basin contains a huge amount of bitumen, which if it were developed would outstrip every kind of source of oil in the world. So that's why it's the largest development in the world today. When we talk about the tar sands, it is not only the size of England itself, but it's also a very hard to get at resource. And I'm going to be talking about the different technologies that have been used to get that resource out. But basically, strip mining, where it started, is only capable of getting up to 5% of what's there. The rest required new and very innovative forms of technology. Secondly, the amount of money that has been projected for investment in the tar sands amounted to over $2 trillion. Now, this was before the sudden decline in world oil prices. But had things continued, the plan was that over the next 25 years, over $2 trillion would have been invested in the extraction of bitumen from the tar sands. The bitumen itself is like a very thick, tarry substance. It's like the same kind of material that's used to put on, to pave our roads. And it's the same kind of tarring of the roads that's done. That exists below the sedimentary rock basin, and the only way to extract it and get it out is to find new technology, the technology to do that. And we will come to that in just a minute. The total resources far exceed Saudi Arabia, as I said, and even Venezuela. And the other thing to keep in mind, that the companies that are operating and extracting the bitumen, whether it's through mining or the process called the in situ method, the companies involved are some of the biggest companies in four continents. The United States itself, of course, I should say four countries or continents. The United States has ConocoPhillips and Chevron Texaco, et cetera, all those big companies are involved. The European giants, the big French companies, and the Norwegian companies, Italian, et cetera, are all involved. Asian countries, led by China, but also other various other Asian countries, are also involved. And of course, Canadian companies are there as well. So we're talking about a mixture of huge numbers of countries from around the world or have a stake in the tar sands and are at the forefront of the development that's taking place there. The kind of extraction technology that's used to get the bitumen out of the ground beneath the sedimentary rock basin really involves some really innovative technology. And as I said, the new technology that has been developed is called in situ. In situ is a Latin word meaning in place. And basically what this in situ technology does is to, first of all, drill two wells. And if you follow this part right down here of the two wells down, and then to move horizontally in relationship to each other. The top well is then injected with boiling hot water, which generates steam. Now, this is really important that it generates steam. The steam then loosens the oil from the bitumen, which then drops into the bottom well. So the bottom well takes the oil that is loosened from the bitumen in there. And then that heavy crude that's there is pumped up to the surface. So that's called the in situ method. And the extraction itself generates 2.5 times more greenhouse gas emissions than does the mining methodology, the strip mining methodology, that used to be the preferred way of getting the bitumen out of the ground. So the in situ extraction then is, and that methodology is really key to what happens in the tar sands today. Now, right now, Canada probably, from the tar sands, exports somewhere around 2.4, 2.5 million barrels of oil from the tar sands every day. That is almost exclusively to the United States right now. The projections had been with that $2 trillion investment that I was talking about before, was that by the year 2030 to 2035, we would be in the ballpark of four to five million barrels a day exports, and then later on by 2040 and a little later, somewhere in the neighborhood of about 6 million or six million barrels a day. So you get an idea that that had all been part of the projection. That slowed down because of the lower price of oil. Once the price of oil returns to a certain state, and that remains to be seen when, how quite quickly or whatever, these plans will come on side again, and we will see that fast forward movement take place. So what we see at the same time here is also a problem of greenhouse gas emissions being generated from tar sands production alone. And every year right now, as of, 2015, Canada's generation of greenhouse gas emissions from tar sands production amounted to 70 million tons a year. That will go, from 2016, that will go to up to a ceiling that's been set for 100 million tons in 2020. The reason that happened is that the newly elected government in Alberta has had negotiations with the tar sands industry, and that's in tune with their projection of where they see things changing with the world price of oil going up further, therefore allowing expanded production to take place. It also runs smack in the face of the Trudeau government's commitment to stick to the Paris Accord. You can't stick to the Paris Accord and be adding another 30 million tons to our already high levels of fairly high levels of greenhouse gas emissions. You can't do that. And what this amounts to, this 30 million tons addition, is a 43% increase in what was there before. So you can tell the influence and power of the petroleum industry behind the scenes. Now, on top of all this, the story gets worse because the tar sands also produces a great deal of methane. And it does this directly through the burning of natural gas for its in-situ process. The only way it is able to fuel its in-situ process has been through the burning of natural gas. The only other option would have been nuclear energy. And so what's happening right now is there's an increase in methane releases that's been going on now for several years through this in-situ process and methodology. What's that? What the increase in methane has been doing, unbeknownst to the Canadian government really following this, has been melting the tundra and the permafrost of the Northwest Territories, which is the period of land between the most populated area of Canada and the Arctic Circle. And that melting process has contributed enormously to the melting of the ice shield in the Arctic itself. And I'll come back to that in a few moments. But basically, what has not been said so far about methane is the following, and I want you to try to really understand this. Methane is 85% more powerful than carbon dioxide during the first 20 years of its release into the atmosphere. First 20 years of methane's release into the atmosphere has a 85% more powerful impact than does CO2 or carbon emissions. And over a 100-year period, that concentration gets reduced, but still methane outstrips the power, damaging power of carbon dioxide by 25% over a 100-year period. So we're talking about a very, very powerful greenhouse gas, and only discovering it within the last few years and understanding its impacts. So I think it's really important that we grapple with that. Bill McKibben, who is the founder and leader of the organization, environment organization in the U.S. called 350.org, sounded the alarm on this by calling it methane, global warming's terrifying chemistry. Global warming's terrifying chemistry. Okay, let's go to the next one, okay? As I said before, all of the oil and gas production in Canada is really landlocked, and it has to get to market by being transported either by pipelines or in some cases by tankers. And I just want to point out that the big pipeline debate that's going on in Canada right now, I remember that slide we saw with a bunch of all those different pipelines? The one that's really big right now is the Kinder Morgan project called the Trans Mountain Pipeline. And it is under a huge spotlight of controversy and public debate as we speak right now. Because if that gets the green light from the Trudeau government as expected, it will open the door for more rapid export and more rapid movement of oil from the tar sands to the rest of not only to the United States but even more so to Asian markets. So that's all part of a picture now that is really going on. I could go on with a lot of each one of those pipelines has a story. I won't tell those stories at all, but I just want you to know that there is a huge set of concerns. And the other set of concerns is the leakage and the spills from pipelines. Recently, January and February of this year, there was a leak in one big pipeline leaking something like 250,000 liters of oil into the North Saskatchewan River. 250,000 liters of oil into the North Saskatchewan River. Okay, let's move to liquefied natural gas, and I'll try to go through this much quicker because we've already heard a lot already on this. But just less than 2 weeks ago, the Canadian government announced that it was going to approve a huge liquefied natural gas terminal up the coast of British Columbia. You heard the conversation about British Columbia earlier, the most western province in Canada. setting up an establishment of a liquefied natural gas plant the hydraulic fracturing of shale oil itself, and have it transported to this plant where it'd be turned into liquefied natural gas and then taken down the West Coast to be shipped to markets in Asia and to the United States. Let's go to the next one, please. You can see here on this chart some of the newest projects dealing with liquefied natural gas terminals that have cropped up recently. The various dots in red and that are around, you can see here are some of the existing plants, followed by the approved ones, followed by the proposed ones. And I just want to say that this is in North America alone, but I want to draw your attention not only to two areas, the increase up and down the west coast of British Columbia for liquefied natural gas, followed based upon this plant that will be developed in Kitimat. And then secondly, the concentration in the Mexican Gulf there, the Gulf of Mexico, and seeing the growing area of that's being taken up for these liquefied natural gas terminals. Move to the next one, please. The one that I'm going to talk about is this Kitimat plant very briefly, and just to say that, as I say, it's as recent as this past few weeks. It's a $36 billion enterprise. Yet it also has its downsides. It's $36 billion, yes, but it only produces 4,500 jobs. Not all of them are going to be permanent jobs. So you have to ask yourself the question, what's the value of that? You have to ask yourself the question of what's the value when that same plant in its first year of operation will generate 24 million tons of greenhouse gas emissions. So it's adding to the compilation of greenhouse gas emissions from Canada. And it's also going to be adding to the methane leaks as well. And so when you put this together, you have to ask that question, what's the value of all of this? And what are we seeing coming from this? I think that the other thing to keep in mind is that those kinds of plants are very dangerous. They can you saw the flare, I think, that existed in the other slides we saw with Anthony. But I think I would say on top of this, you have a multiplication of these kinds of risks, and the burning impact from that flare can also burn skin of people that are very within a mile of the flares themselves, and it can also create other kinds of health hazards, which I think need to be understood and taken into consideration. And we'll hear more of that tomorrow from Seth, I think. The hydraulic fracking technology that's used is basically drilling well bores that go down 6,000 to 10,000 feet. There is something like over 100 of these drilling operations now in the BC West Coast area near the Kitimat plant. As you know, the whole process involves sending a pipe gun down that sort of digs into the moves into the process in a horizontal way, and what it ends up doing is that it turns turns part of the wellbore into an explosion that can generate a huge amount of shale and fracturing in the shale itself. So this is the process that more or less has been used, and we heard another rendition of that earlier. Basically, the fracking fluid that we're talking about is being used in the one in British Columbia is 10 to 20 million liters of water from groundwater sources, mixed with thousands of different kinds of chemicals and thousands of pounds of sand being thrown in the mix as well. And when you put all of this into the mix and then pump at high pressures into the fractures that are created, releasing the gas into the well, which is then siphoned out and then taken back to the plant for conversion into liquefied natural gas. So this is the way in which the process has been unfolding, and recent studies have also shown that 90% of the water that's injected back into the geological system, where it can goes back into the geological system, where it can induce seismic disruptions and earthquakes, just like we heard earlier. So already the studies are showing that up to 90% of the water injected back in there has enormous effects. Looking at the greenhouse gas emissions in terms of methane produced, we are looking at the global warming and potential of all this. I just want to remind you that methane traps 25 times as much heat as carbon dioxide over 100 years and 85 times as much heat over 20 years. That's the formula I think we need to keep in mind. The fracking wells leak 40 to 60% more methane than conventional natural gas wells. And this methane, I should say, when the water is forced down into the fracking well, it, in order to fracture the rock formations, this methane flows up the well and is released into the atmosphere before it can be captured. The leaked methane is called fugitive methane and has been detected using infrared videos. And the impact upon wildlife of all of this happening in the northwest part of British Columbia is such that the bear population is definitely affected, and we're talking about that white bear being a very rare breed called the spirit bear by indigenous peoples, and they are directly affected, as is the salmon in the red below, and the whales out in the orca whales out in the seaside. Okay, and this is of course due to both pipelines going through the Great Bear forest area affecting the wildlife, the bears and the salmon, and then salmon runs, and then with the tankers taking the rest of the liquefied natural gas down the coast to ports in Burnaby and in Vancouver, this whole process itself threatens the orca whales off the coast of British Columbia. Okay, let's move then to the whole question of how this impacts in terms of the melting of the Arctic. And you can see how fast the Arctic is melting when we look at a picture that was taken of the ice cap, polar ice caps back in 1980, versus to the right, what it looks like in 2012. And that impact is exactly, tells the whole story in and of itself. What has happened to all that ice and the melting of that ice? Now, many people will ask the question, why do we worry about the Arctic? Why worry about that? Well, we worry about it because the Arctic, the melting, I should say, the ice caps in the polar areas of the continent, whether that be the Arctic or the Antarctic, really play a major role in regulating the whole question of a more moderate climate globally. In other words, they keep the polar region, by keeping the polar regions cool, that balances off the heating that is going on constantly with regards to the planet. And so if you melt the ice in the Arctic, then you're simply opening the door to real serious problems elsewhere in the continent with regards to climate change. And another way of looking at this is to say that the sea ice in the Arctic has a bright surface, very bright. And if you want to, just a second. It has a very bright surface, and 80% of the sunlight that strikes that ice surface in the Arctic is reflected back into space. And as sea ice melts in the summer, it exposes this dark ocean surface, and instead of reflecting the 80% of the sunlight back into the atmosphere, it exposes the dark ocean surface. It absorbs the sunlight and causes constant problems with regards to the heating of the planet. So the more ice is melted in the polar regions, the more it opens the door to further acceleration of climate change throughout the entire planet. The loss of sea ice also has a potential to accelerate this kind of global warming trend. And when you see the stats now that they've been able to pull together at NASA, the National Aerospace Association, when you see the studies that they have done, they have come to the conclusion that Arctic sea ice thickness and its decline is declining at a rate of 17% per decade. So 17% of the ice caps are declining every decade. And that's been since the 1980s, right here, okay? The methane impact is equally great. If we turn the next slide, please. You can see how the source is NASA and the work that has been done there by the various scientists. The image here is of a methane concentration globally, and using the atmospheric infrared sounder instrument that has been developed by NASA. So you can see, as we go north and further north, the impact of methane is far, far greater in the northern hemisphere. And therefore, the melting of the Arctic and of the ice flows in the Siberia and so on and so forth are increasing as a result of that methane process and speeding up at a much faster rate. So what this all does is, this NASA Goddard Institute space study chart shows again where this has been accelerating. The brown parts at the top plus the orange parts are the areas that are most sensitive to this process right now. What this particular chart shows is that whereas the average increase between 1951 and 1980 was 1.35 degrees, what's happened in the first 16 years of this year is an increase of 1.35 degrees that we're facing right now. And that goes back to what I said about the 1.5, how close, dangerously close we are already to 1.5 degree increase. That's the documentation of it right there. But the interesting thing is that when you talk about these areas with the brown and the orange coloring and so forth, especially the brown areas, that these are areas that are most directly affected by a much faster increase, and those are the Arctic areas. In February of this year, the temperature had increased 5.4 degrees Celsius in the Arctic. 5.4 degrees Celsius in the Arctic. So it's not just that the melting is taking place, but it's taking place at a much faster rate in the Arctic, and in the Arctic it is proceeding at a rate that is far faster than the rest of the planet. And I think those are things that we need to take into consideration. Before we end that part, though, there is another hidden agenda that goes back to the global economy. And that is, why is it that people are excited about the melting of the ice caps in the Arctic, even though the ocean floor or ocean sea levels will rise? Yes, of course, they're concerned about that. But what they're really happy about is that it opens up the Northwest Passage. And the Northwest Passage means that finally there is a much faster and quicker connection between Europe and North America on the one hand and Asia on the other. And therefore, we'll be able to speed up global trade, speed up the global economy, see greater economic growth as a result of the opening up of the Northwest Passage. And that's what we're dealing with in terms of the pressure that's on. Finally, just to round this part off, is to say that, you know, the concentration of greenhouse gas emissions in the atmosphere, the impact of all of this, in terms of the melting of the Arctic, surely raises questions in our own minds about what this really means for things like the global climate accord reached in Paris on the one hand, and also the agreement that was reached regarding in terms of NAFTA and the free trade area that we're all a part of, and what that really means in terms of the reduction of the commitment to and the agreement to reduce methane by 40 to 45% by 2025. Yes, these promises were made. These goals were set. But nowhere is there a plan of action to reach those goals. Even though it's up to each country to come up with a plan of action, even the benchmarks aren't clearly laid out as to what needs to be achieved to get there. So that's why I say that the climate change challenge is really the geopolitical challenge of the 21st century. One obviously cannot talk about it without talking about water, but one can't talk about the geopolitical challenge of the 21st century without talking about climate change. And that's why the linkage has been made. Finally, do I have time or am I out of time?
5 minutes? Like 5 minutes, 10 minutes.
Okay. Let me go to the final part of the presentation. And I just want to say that we in Canada and the social movements have been organizing for several years now to build a new alliance that brings together progressive thinking and acting people in various sectors of the economy and society, including Indigenous peoples and environment groups and labor unions, but also progressive NGOs and public interest groups and youth organizations and faith-based communities, etc., to try to work together around a common agenda and to bring about the transformation that's urgently needed. A few years ago, we began this process and new coalitions of various kinds have been forming. We have in Canada something called the LEAP Manifesto, which kind of put forward a vision, but again, without a roadmap. And what we've been trying to do is to build on the vision and build on the work that's going on, but to develop a roadmap that goes hand in hand with it. The central challenge that we see emerging here has to do with the transition that needs to be made in the next 25 to 30 years between a fossil fuel-based economy to one that is based upon renewable, clean, renewable energy sources. A fundamental transition that needs to be made. And secondly, that we also have been saying that we need to focus the fight against climate change in such a way as to fight against, at the same time, and overcome poverty, unemployment, and austerity. To bring these two processes together and to see the common links between them. And one way of tackling all of this, we have concluded, is to put forward a new set of demands or a new platform and a set of demands and priorities that need to be met. And here are the basic, and I'll go through them very briefly in a second. The first is industrial transformation. We can't move in this kind of a direction without fundamentally changing certain parts of the industrial machine that has emerged over the last several hundred years. And one of those is the fossil fuel industry. Very clearly, that's a target. It has to be fundamentally overhauled and dismantled in many cases and completely reorganized to serve other interests and priorities. And behind this is the understanding that we need to move from an industrial model, a super industrial model, to a more ecological model of economic development in the future. The second priority has to do with creating, if you will, new forms of employment. We need to be thinking much more creatively about how people can acquire an income, a decent income, and do so in a way that they contribute to the building of a healthy economy in the future. There's no sense in blaming workers for being involved in the tar sands industry or in liquefied natural gas or in hydraulic fracking or whatever. They were put there. They had no choice. It's time that we started to create an economy that really is an investment in sustainability for the future. And that means creating a new line of employment. We call them climate jobs. And people say, climate jobs? I thought they were green jobs. No. We're saying climate jobs. Why? Because these are jobs that contribute, where the people working in those jobs contribute directly to the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions that are causing climate change and global warming and the heating of the planet and the burning of the planet. So we put people to work in healthy industries that move in that direction. And I'll briefly show you them in a second. Thirdly, we talk about the need for a just transition plan, that workers aren't simply thrown out of work, but there is a transition and a retraining process whereby they can make a transition from a dirty energy industry to a clean energy future, industry or working situation in the future. And finally, we say that this can only happen through the public sector. Don't leave it to the private sector and the markets to lead the way. Yes, they will have a role and they have a role to play, but it's going to have to be led by the public sector and by governments. And governments are going to have to invest to make it happen. And so we have laid out targeted investment plans, public investment plans, which would gain with these results. So let me just go through, just the transformation one. I just want to say that, you know, this whole connection between dismantling the oil, the petroleum industry, and restructuring where it goes and everything else, what happens? We're talking about the next 20, 25 years, and certainly at the most 30 years to make this transition take place. But we need a plan of action, and we need ways of doing this, and we need to put people to work thinking about how to make this transition take place. You know, Anthony, when he was talking earlier, talked about, well, it's been, there are models. Germany has put a plan in place and said you've got 15 or 20 years to do it. Well, that's the, but we, you know, that's the kind of leadership that's going to be needed. But the details have to be worked out in terms of the kinds of things we're talking about. But taking a stance along those lines is important. Equally important is to not only invest in, but also have a plan for growing wind power, solar power, geothermal power, for you know, in some countries like my own, tidal power. And other possibilities for generating electrical power through the various sources that we're talking about, and creating a nationwide or continental-wide energy grids that will be able to take that power and distribute it right across the board. Those are things that need to be done, but they are forward-thinking. And people say, well, you can't do that. There's just... you know, you're going to be disrupting the oil industry over here. You're going to be. Governments just don't have the capacity to do that. All I'm saying is, think back what happened in World War II and the build up. Once a decision was made that there was a common enemy, then suddenly the resources were there to rebuild industry and to rebuild it right across the board for the war effort. Well, there's a common enemy we face, and it's called climate change. And maybe that's what we should be doing, is calling upon governments to rethink, retool, recapacitate themselves to move in this direction and to be able to give the leadership that's necessary. I did not wait for that. Again, a well-coordinated plan of action needs to go side by side with that in terms of building up this renewable energy future, and we've already talked about that. So we'll just go on to the next slide, if you will. And I just want to show you this chart for a minute, and then another chart. These are charts that we have worked out in the work that we're doing back in Canada. And, you know, it doesn't make much sense, perhaps, to in Mexican terms, but... you know, a fair amount of homework was done on this, and we have a model for doing this now, and we can share the model, and then people can work at it in their own countries. But we've come to a decision as to how many billions of dollars over a five-year period is required to get this process underway. And we say $23.3 billion in renewable energy, $30 billion in energy efficiency, which is building retrofits, because we live in a climate with extreme heat and cold, and we've got to stop wasting so much energy through the heating of our buildings and the cooling of our buildings. To retrofit our buildings to withstand that would be another $30 billion. Public transit, expanding public transit, and also building high-speed rail to move people and freight around, and thereby creating more jobs that contribute to reduction of greenhouse gas emissions by taking cars off the road. All of that worked out comes to an $80.9 billion price tag for a five-year pattern of investment. That's not a year, that's not $80 billion over a year, it's $80 billion over a five-year period. You know, there was a study done in Canada as to what would be the economic costs of not doing that sort of thing or moving in that direction. And the result was a $90 billion price tag per year if we just don't do anything. So those that say the money isn't there ought to think again about what's going to happen when we don't do anything and we sit back and we let it rest. Next slide, I just want to show, put these together. That column, in again, with the same kinds of projects and programs, renewable energy, energy efficiency, public transit, higher speed rail, put over and against the amount of investment, as I indicated right down the columns there. Then that translates into job creation. These are total person job years created. For renewable energy, 290,000. 438,000 for energy efficiency, 223,000 jobs in public transit, another 101,000 jobs in high-speed rail. And then in the final column, this is the range of greenhouse gas emissions that could be reduced as a result of that kind of investment and that kind of job creation. And here you see a range on renewable energy. By making that kind of investment in renewable energy and sticking to it and reaching the targets, we will reduce greenhouse gas emissions by a low of 44 million tons of carbon to a high of 110 million tons of carbon. And a lot of that has to do with different variables that are in the mix. But it'll go from a low to a high, et cetera. The same in terms of energy efficiency, less so with public transit because public transit takes longer to kick in. The ridership effect is different in to convert people. You invest in public transit, but it takes longer for people to make a choice and decision to ditch their car on the one hand and take public transit. But it does happen over a period of time. So the impacts of public transit are going to be after the first 5 years. This is the kind of work that we have done anyway to get our work ball rolling back in Canada. And I say to you, that's what we're doing in the Great White North up there. And we're happy to share it, but we're really happy to learn more from down here. Okay? Take care.